Welcome to Brian Lehrer Live. We're here live Wednesday nights at 7:30. Tonight, Democratic strategists James Carville and Paul Begala. We'll get to them in just a minute on Bill Clinton's Fox News tirade and what it could mean for the future, not just the past of the Democratic Party. Then later tonight, Olbermann does Murrow.
1 month ago tonight, we presented a report on Senator Joseph R. McCarthy.
And now a special comment about the president's speech today.
But right now, Democratic strategist James Carville and Paul Begala. You know them from other kinds of channels on cable TV, maybe. And they've both worked closely with former President Bill Clinton, so they're in a good position to look at some of Mr. Clinton's Fox News stare down with us and talk about what it means, not just in terms of the former president's personal legacy, but also this year's battle for control of Congress. And we'll view some internet campaign video, too. Carville and Begala have a new paperback edition of their book, Take It Back, A Battle Plan for Democratic Victory. And it's funny, my guests are here as part of a series we're doing on how internet video is becoming a crucial battleground in the campaign for control of Congress this year. But we didn't think we'd have something this new and juicy and directly relevant to them. We suspect that by Election Day, more people will have seen this by passing it around online than were watching Fox Network first thing Sunday morning. In case you missed it, here's about 2 minutes of the confrontation between Chris Wallace of Fox News Sunday and former President Bill Clinton on the issue of whether Clinton ducked the chance to apprehend Osama bin Laden.
I understand that hindsight is always 20/20.
No, let's talk about it.
But the question is, why didn't you do more, connect the dots, and put him out of business?
All right, let's talk about it. I will answer all those things on the merits, but first I want to talk about the context in which this arises. I'm being asked this on the Fox Network. ABC just had a right-wing conservative running their little pathway to 9/11, falsely claiming it was based on the 9/11 Commission report, with three things asserted against me directly contradicted by the 9/11 Commission report. And I think it's very interesting that all the conservative Republicans who now say I didn't do enough claim that I was too obsessed with bin Laden. All of President Bush's neocons thought I was too obsessed with bin Laden. They had no meetings on bin Laden for 9 months after I left office. All the right-wingers who now say I didn't do enough said I did too much. Same people. They were all trying to get me to withdraw from Somalia in 1993, the next day after we were involved in Black Hawk Down, and I refused to do it and stayed 6 months and had an orderly transfer to the United Nations. Okay, now let's look at all the criticisms. Black Hawk Down, Somalia. There is not a living soul in the world who thought Osama bin Laden had anything to do with Black Hawk Down or was paying any attention to it or even knew Al-Qaeda was a going concern in October of 93.
I understand.
No, wait. Don't tell me this. You asked me why didn't I do more to bin Laden. There was not a living soul. All the people who now criticize me wanted to leave the next day. You brought this up, so you get an answer. Secondly,
bin Laden says
that bin Laden may have said
bin Laden says,
that,
but it showed the weakness of the United
but
States.
But it would have shown the weakness if we'd left right away. But he wasn't involved in that. That's just a bunch of bull. That was about Muhammad Adid, a Muslim warlord, murdering 22 Pakistani Muslim troops. We were all there on a humanitarian mission. We had no mission, none, to establish a certain kind of Somali government or keep anybody out. He was not a religious fanatic.
But Mr. President,
there was no Al-Qaeda.
If I may, instead of going through 93 and 96...
No, you ask it. You brought it up.
May I ask you a general question and then you can answer?
Yeah.
And on they went on Sunday morning on Fox News. James Carville, who ambushed whom?
Look, I think that you got to put it in the context. We had the Disney fiction that they tried to send out to school children.
The ABC
I think
movies?
The ABC movies. And I think the president was agitated, felt like, as did any neutral observer, every neutral observer, felt like it's tremendously unfair. I think if you look at Fox News and you look at they're very apologetic for Bush, and he asked the question, and you know, as you would expect from Bill Clinton, he had his facts right. And he was irritated, but even when Bill Clinton is irritated, he's still the smartest man in America.
Well,
and his facts were just about dead on.
Everybody's arguing about whose facts are right, but he must have known after the ABC thing that that question was coming, and he was ready
to tear it up. I was not in the room, but I was nearby. I was in town for the Clinton Global Initiative, and I talked to people who were in the room literally as it was winding down. It wasn't even over yet. And I got a call from somebody who was there like, you're not going to believe. You know, it was great. I believe from people who were there that he went into it with a bit of a chip on his shoulder because it was Fox News. But that was it. Not thinking, oh, they're going to try to sandbag me. They're going to try to ask questions about bin Laden, et cetera. Wallace did not violate the ground rules, really, because there was a 15-minute deal, and half of it had to be about the global initiative. Mm-hmm. Half had to be about anything else.
But it was two questions into it, he went to something else.
But it was it was not halfway into it that he switched off of it.
Right.
Now,
Wallace says it didn't have to be the first half or the second half.
I think it was a combination of the fact that it seemed early in the interview, and it was. And it's Fox News. Come on, you know, put the cards on the table. This is a network that has had it out for Bill Clinton since the day they first broadcast.
Yeah, but I said we were going to put this in the context of control of Congress and the battle that's going on this fall. Was this calculated on the part of Bill Clinton to rile the base of the Democratic Party? Because so much of who wins elections this fall is dependent on the base turning out, not convincing swing voters.
Right. It was authentic. I mean, James and I have known President Clinton for 15 years. He's a man who wears his heart on his sleeve. Once it happened, it has had that exact effect. Democrats, to their great credit, have rallied around the president. The Democratic National Committee is getting thousands and thousands of emails and volunteers. They're getting contributions coming in. This is an enormous benefit for Democrats to rally the base in much the same way that Republicans used Mary Mapes, the producer at CBS, and Dan Rather's mistakes using forged and fraudulent documents to prove a larger truth. It was a true story. It was just forged documents.
They
used that to rally their base. Now, I know people who believe that, you know, Karl Rove forged those documents because it was so helpful to Bush. He didn't, I don't believe. But it happened. Yeah. If you're a good politician, you can be opportunistic.
I think that swing voters do matter. I think they both matter. I don't think they're sort of mutually exclusive. I think Democrats would not serve themselves well if they didn't address concerns of swing voters or highly partisan voters. And I think what we see in our research and what more and more people are seeing is that the Republicans are getting their base back, but they're paying an awesome price with independents or moderate Republicans, mainstream Protestants.
To get their base, for example, President Bush, to go back to 2004, increased his vote by 11 million votes without increasing his popularity in America. How did he do that? They called the strategy anger points. In writing this book, James and I interviewed a whole bunch of people who helped run President Bush's campaign. Mm-hmm. And they called it anger points. The voters who were underperforming Republicans, they were conservative, but they tended not to vote. They weren't in love with George Bush. So they didn't go to them and say, Bush is a great guy. They tended to be very strongly pro-life, and so they hit them with abortion. They tend to be very anti-gay, so they hit them with gay rights stuff. And they made them angry. Well, that's good for Bush. He won the election on that. But he brought them in the party. And guess what? He had to then serve them. That's why we had the Terry Schiavo nightmare, where all of a sudden the Congress of the United States is trying to intervene in a woman's deathbed. And that's the problem when you go to the extreme the way Mr. Bush did. You pay a price in the center.
So, James Carville, are there Democratic anger points, and is the party trying to exploit them this year?
Well, of course, there are Democratic anger points. I mean, the war is obviously a huge anger point. I think a larger Democratic anger point is that there seems to be no accountability. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you keep hearing, good God, can you imagine if there were a Democratic president that was grossly negligent as this administration was during Katrina? Could you imagine if you took a $5.4 trillion surplus and turn it into a $300 billion deficit that people were actually calling it progress? If you started a war, and to anyone's knowledge, you never asked a single question about the occupation. So that, I mean, the Democrats have, their anger is stoked up. I think what President Clinton did, he might have, he had a chip on his shoulder. He probably could, he might have said, you know what, one thing, I'm going to let him have it, because I'm just, he probably felt like a lot of Democrats did, I know, like I feel all the time, is I've just had enough of this. It's just kind of what was his name, Fannie Lou Hamer said, I'm just sick and tired of being sick and tired.
Right.
You know, and I think that probably could have been some of that.
A lot of Democrats feel that way right now.
Right.
You have a public out there, and we're going to open up our phones if anybody wants to talk to James Carville and Paul Begala tonight. You watch them on other TV channels, maybe where you can call up and talk to them. Now you can. 212 251-0801, 251-0801. And after watching a former president trade barbs with Fox News, let's look to the future. This is an ad that Republican Congresswoman Nancy Johnson of Connecticut is running to try and discredit her Democratic opponent, Chris Murphy. Let's watch.
Call is placed in New York to a known terrorist in Pakistan. A terrorist plot may be unfolding. Should the government intercept that call or wait until the paperwork is filed? Nancy Johnson says act immediately. Lives may be at stake. Liberal Chris Murphy says no. Apply for a court warrant, even if valuable time is lost. Chris Murphy, wrong on security, wrong for America.
James Carville?
If I was critiquing that, that is a the ad's well done, except that they did have made a classic mistake. Is they took a bad picture of Chris Murphy, and people really picked that up. I know Chris Murphy.
They're trying to make him look bad.
I understand, but the vote, you'd be surprised.
It tells voters
it's an unfair ad. If you just have the guy looking like they see him on TV.
You know what Roger Ailes used to do? Roger Ailes now runs the Fox Network.
Right,
in our day, he was a political consultant for George Bush Sr., who we ran against when President Clinton got elected. He would take the official campaign photo of his opponent and use it in the ad, except he'd reverse the image.
Huh.
And so voters would sort of think, well, that looks like Clinton, but the part was on the wrong side, and it was a little disconcerting, but it didn't seem unfair.
Pretty smart guy. I know Chris Murphy, and that's not what Chris Murphy is for, but we're not going to go to the accuracy of the ad. It's a pretty well-done ad. I think it made a classic mistake of taking a bad picture because voters see Chris Murphy on TV, and he's really quite a nice-looking guy, and they said that, if they don't have the right picture of him, what else did they get right?
All right. Now, I want to compare that one with another one from the other side of the aisle. So let's jump across the aisle. This next clip is another political ad, this time that wants us to think about terrorism, too. But this one is from Harry Ford, Jr., a Democrat from Tennessee. Let's watch.
Once again, terrorists tried to take down passenger planes, this time with liquid explosives. Thank God the British stopped them. I'm Harold Ford, Jr. The bipartisan 9/11 Commission says our airports fail on security, 5 years after September the 11th. And today our ports and borders remain vulnerable to terrorists. It's time to put aside politics, adopt the Commission's 41 recommendations, and get tough on controlling our borders. I approve this message because there's nothing more important than our security.
Paul Begala, never mind that he looks 15 years old.
He's gorgeous, He's a friend of mine, but he's gorgeous.
The Democrats are fighting on the issue of terrorism.
Mm-hmm. Very, very smart. You cannot, in 02 and in 04, Democrats walked away from national security. They said, Bush has too big a lead, and too many of them, I think, voted for that god-awful war just because of politics. Ford is saying, no, wait, we're tougher. And it turns out, on the substance, he's also right. You know, there are detectors that can detect liquid explosives. And I'm not revealing anything secret, but we have them at the White House. They have them at the Supreme Court. They're not very expensive. They're $30,000 to $80,000 a copy. We could have them at every airport. We could have had them 5 years ago at every airport. The Bush administration declined to protect America. So Ford's right on the facts, but I think it's a very good ad as well, because it's tough on terrorism.
Did he thank the British in that?
He thanked God. He said, thank God the British.
Most people tell me he's probably running the best campaign, the best candidate of the entire country, of all of the Democrats this year. And who knows, but he's well within striking distance down there.
Let's take a phone call. This is Doug in, is it Arden Heights? Hi, Doug.
Arden Heights, Staten Island.
Hey.
Good evening. Hi, Paul and James.
Hey, Doug. How you doing?
Well, it's a pleasure. It's a pleasure to talk to you guys.
Thank you, sir.
I am a proud member of the liberal, progressive, democratic member of the opposition party. And I'm wondering what happened to the likes of you guys, and why don't we have guys like Steve Jodding and Dave Mudcat Sanders running the Democrats? I watched today 39-30 being debated, and it seems like this is Iraq 2002 reprise all over again.
All right, now wait a minute.
Let me make my point.
All right,
please.
I'm going to have to get the rest of the viewers a definition of 39-30 in a minute, but go ahead.
All right. Well, that sets the military tribunals and detainee act. It doesn't pass the smell test. Okay? Instead, what we're going to do is say, like Iraq reprise, let's give the president what he wants because we got to go home to campaign.
Okay. Paul, we talked about this on the radio on Monday, and you said if it's good enough for John McCain, if it passes his smell test, it should be good enough for the Democrats. That was on Monday.
On torture.
On the
rather than tribunals,
on
two
the
different
detainees,
pieces of
right.
two different pieces of legislation.
But on this whole,
I think it's important difference.
But then on Tuesday, Republican Senator Arlen Specter stood up and said, "No, this is not good enough because it doesn't allow the writ of habeas corpus to apply. That is, detainees can't challenge their detainment in court, detention." And where are the Democrats standing up and say we're going to vote against this bill?
But they're two different issues.
Okay.
One is the treatment of prisoners, the interrogation methods.
Right.
Okay. On that, most Americans, and I do too, largely trust McCain because he was tortured and he has been very strong against that. The second bill is this question of what due process is due to detainees, not what interrogation procedures will be proscribed.
Okay.
And I think on that, Specter is right. You have got to have, and the Supreme Court in the Hamdan case said, you've got to have some measure of due process. You cannot have even in time of war, the President of the United States just seizing people and locking them up forever.
Well, what Paul says is true. You have to be careful to separate the two issues. Unfortunately, today I've been gone from one thing to another. I had a chance to watch the news, but I was told that like a bunch of ex-ambassadors, many of them Republicans, have come out against this. I think the big danger that we face is that the rest of the world looks at this, where our reputation is shot to hell in a handbasket anyway, and sees us as a nation not in accord with international standards, or what we'd call top tier international
standards. But here's my question about the Democratic Party.
Right.
I could open up the phones on the radio show on WNYC or here and take calls from New York Democrats all night who will say, you know, fight the Bush administration on detainees, fight the Bush administration on the warrantless wiretaps, set a timetable to get out of Iraq.
Right.
But the actual elected Democrats or the candidates kind of waffle around the
you
middle
know why?
On this.
Because there's not public support for that. I mean, you go out, I'm just stating the fact. People... Or you know the phone
their
calls
finger to the wind instead of their values.
Well, you know what? They're politicians, and you can't you put your finger if you got 5% of the country that wants something, generally it doesn't pass in a democracy.
I understand.
I think a lot of it is about framing. When Colin Powell, who of course was a general, when John McCain, who was not only a decorated pilot in the Navy, but was tortured himself. When they talk about torture, they don't talk about the alleged terrorist being tortured and his interest. They talk about American soldiers and how a torture policy the likes of which Mr. Bush wants would put our soldiers at risk. Well, all of a sudden, now you've changed the frame. I'm no longer thinking about the guy being tortured. I'm thinking about our troops, right? When James just talked about the question of detainees and habeas corpus and what process they're due, he didn't talk about that soldier. He talked about our image in the world. And I think you can make a case to voters that that's how we're going to win or lose the war on terror. We cannot kill and capture every terrorist out there. We have to stop breeding them. And that's going to be done by the Hearts and Minds campaign.
But one other thing about the party, before we screen another couple of ads, the Republicans, after the 1964 slaughter of Barry Goldwater in the presidential election, started building their base by not worrying about the fact that they were politicians and some of their policies only had 5% support. They started building this conservative base district by district
I just got to step in here. In a large portion of the country, and Lyndon Johnson was right, he knew when he signed the civil rights legislation that he was signing away the Democratic Party in the South. And this idea that somehow or another only the Republicans have principle.
Right.
I mean, that was one of the great principle things that the Democratic Party did. It is why I am a member of that party. So let's be historically accurate here. The Democratic Party did a very just and a very unpopular thing
when it
became the party of civil rights.
And they have remained the party of civil rights in the face of loss after loss after loss. When I was a kid in Texas, Republicans didn't even run statewide. They didn't run. Okay, today we have 19 statewide elected officials in Texas. That's not congressmen, that's ag commissioner, everything else. 100%
paying the price for civil rights.
Republicans.
Yes.
Yes, but Republicans also made important accommodations. I'm working, actually researching a book right now on President Reagan and President Clinton. I've interviewed most of Reagan's old hands, some who are no longer with us. Thank God I got them interviewed before they left. And, for example, Reagan was as bitterly opposed to Medicare as anybody could be. He called it socialism. By the time he ran for president, he was all for it. Mm. Why? He still hated it, but the public wanted it. He acknowledged the public, you know. Yeah.
Let's return to the world of political ads one more time. This next clip is for Democrat Chris Carney in a race against Republican Don Sherwood in the 10th Congressional District in Pennsylvania. Let's watch.
Chris Carney. His leadership, courage, and patriotism make him one of our best Democratic candidates and one of our most talented Democratic veterans, which is why Time calls him Karl Rove's worst nightmare. And Democratic Avenger declares, we have a winner. Chris Carney deserves our support. PA-10 coming this fall.
All right. That's targeted. that's targeted to
the people I was just talking
highly
about, right? Right now, that's an online ad. I don't think that's running on television.
That's a fundraising ad.
You see the reference to the Huffington Post and to Daily Coast.
Right.
So this is a fundraising ad. They're trying to raise money on this, I think. Right. What do you think?
I agree with you. I think I don't want to get out there too far, but you know what? I think we're right.
Paul Begala?
Yeah.
Context.
Context. This is this guy Carney. Not only is he a naval officer, he's running against Don Sherwood, who is a used car dealer. Nothing wrong with that. But there's something wrong with the Capitol Police were called, or the D.C. police were called, because his girlfriend in Washington accused him of trying to choke her. Now, that's not the kind of family values I think that people in West Wilkes-Barre, Pennsylvania really believe in. And so Mr. Sherwood is desperately in trouble because he's a family values man, you know. But he's accused of choking.
So
he didn't kill her, thank God. And maybe he's innocent. Maybe the woman's making it up. But there's plainly a problem here.
So
Carney has a huge opening because this guy looks like a big hypocrite.
You know, it's just like you and a Democrat. You want to nitpick.
Nitpick. The guy chokes his girlfriend. What the heck?
But you know what? This ad raises another topic that I want to get to this evening. And that is something that came up on the show when we were discussing web video last week. My viewing partner then was John Podoritz, the conservative columnist for the New York Post, and we were talking about the future role of campaign ads on the internet. I want you to watch this clip.
It is on the web.
Because
why is it on the web?
McCain-Feingold.
Because of McCain-Feingold. Third parties, 60 days before an election, it is illegal for them for television stations to run advertising that is not bought by the campaigns themselves. I know the Supreme Court ruled otherwise, but it's a shocking arrogation of power. It is a denial of free speech. And the interesting thing is that the internet is not regulated by McCain-Feingold. And as the years pass, increasingly campaigns are going to be fought on the internet because, of course, TV watching is going to decline. And in politically engaged people are going to be increasingly using the internet solely as a means of finding out their political views. And so McCain-Feingold is doing something that is wrong, but it is also hastening the end of the current form of television campaigning.
Do you agree, for once, with John Podoritz?
Well, if you don't run these ads now, they'll run them somewhere. They'll run them on the internet. That it's good, but I thought it kind of ironic that John Podoritz says I think it's unconstitutional, but the Supreme Court said that it wasn't, and
I think Podoritz is right, and the Supreme Court is wrong.
You do?
Yes, I think it's un-American to
You're
tell.
You're not for McCain-Feingold.
There's a whole lot of good in McCain-Feingold, a whole lot, but I'm really opposed to telling American citizens that 60 days before an election, they can no longer use the name of a candidate in an ad. Okay, I just think that's wrong. I don't think there should be any content restrictions on political speech, especially commercial speech. I understand. I can't sell snake oil and say this will cure cancer. Okay, I understand there should be restrictions on commercial speech. But political speech, 60 days before an election, should be the most protected sanctuary for free speech.
Do you think the Democrats lose more than the Republicans lose by that law and the Supreme Court ruling holding it up?
They actually might. I'm not entirely sure. The Democrats were quicker to get around it with these 527s. You know, in our book,
groups.
we have a very radical campaign reform proposal where any office holder would be allowed to take exactly zero, not one dime.
If you could do it, and we point out how you could do it. The real problem in American politics, at least from my vantage point, or to say our vantage point in all public, is not what goes on TV. It's the money that is raised right. from whom to get that on mm-hmm. TV. You can have these newspapers and stuff, and you can sort of fact check this, and you can point them out. The other side also has the opportunity to answer. It's just not, it shouldn't be a one-way thing. But the problem is you come in and you have all of this interest group money that these politicians desperately need, and you have the confluence of power and a need for money, and that leads to the kind of,
right.
I used to say corrosion, now we can just say corruption at least.
So far, two members of Congress, both Republicans, have pleaded guilty to felonies.
That's correct.
And I will do a shameless plug for my radio show tomorrow morning. We'll be continuing our series on the elections, 30 issues in 30 days, and tomorrow's issue is titled No More Jack Abramoffs, and we're going to look at lobbying, legal and illegal, in America and what it's doing to our political system. But Paul Begala, since your appearance is somewhat in the context of our series on the influence of the Internet in the congressional campaigns, is that ad that we watched and John Podoritz's comment mm-hmm. indicative of an important trend? Is more and more political activity going to migrate to the web, A, yes. to get around McCain-Feingold's restrictions, and B, that's just because where you can really unleash things like that unrestrained ad we saw?
Yes, yes. Now, the problem is it skews to very elite still. I mean, more and more Americans are wired, but they still tend to be, you know, wealthier and whiter and you know, I may be younger, I don't really know, to tell you the truth. But that's a problem. TV still, everybody watches TV. You can still reach people, but I think it's moving that way because of the greater freedom, because you can expand. You know, it's like what you do. You put source material on the web, you let people read a 4 or 40-page document. We can't do that on TV. You can do, so there's much more freedom there, and I think it's good. It's good all the way around.
Ray in Harlem, you're on the air. Hello, Ray.
Hello, how are you?
Good.
I just want to say I'm disappointed with both parties. My question is, how can this administration, due to its secrecy and lies and deception, get away with all the things that they've done? And do you think they're going to be held accountable after they leave office? I mean, the big boys. And my second question is, how have the voting machines and the technology been updated for the next major election? And has that been approved significantly, or are we going to have the same problem?
Ray, before I get an answer for you, I want to ask you a follow-up question. If the Democrats do take control of one or both houses of Congress this fall, do you want to see one of their priorities be to investigate the President of the United States?
Yes, I do, because I think it would be a start for a whole opening of accountability for
okay.
both parties.
Thank you. James Carville, it's November 8th. The Democrats have just won the House. Is this on their agenda?
I think that oversight is going to be on the agenda. You know, we have $9 billion that we sent on an airplane. We can't count for any of it. No, and they refused to investigate. $9 billion.
In Iraq.
In cash. I mean, and no one will look for it.
So the
Henry
contracts,
Waxman,
right?
Yeah, I think that there are...
No, not just contracts. This was
cash
money,
uh-huh.
as we say back home.
Right.
Suitcase
cash.
Full of cash that had to be spread around, apparently. But no, we don't know where it went.
We don't know where it went.
How do you say walking around money?
Walking around. Look, I've been in campaigns and I'm walking around money. $9 billion? And we don't know where it went? So the woman's observation is, I'd say oversight. Mm-hmm. And there has to be some answers here. You know, like today we find out that there's a second NIE report that deals with Iraq, but we're not going to get to see that.
National Intelligence Estimate,
right.
the complete classified version.
Caller said something, and I hear this all the time. Democrats, and I say Democrats, maybe independents, maybe some, do not trust this paperless voting. They do not trust what's going on out there. This woman's comment is not something that she's coming out of left field on. I hear this all the time.
I have to
time.
Say it's one of the most frequent emails that I get from listeners and from viewers. Again, it may be a certain fringe of the Democratic Party.
It's a smart fringe. Michael Waldman is a dear friend of mine. He was President Clinton's chief speechwriter, and he's really a smart man. He runs the Brennan Center for Justice at NYU now. Mm-hmm. And the Brennan Center has done the best serious work on this. And their studies are pretty troubling. about these voting machines. It's not just the crowd with tinfoil on their hat. But let me make a comment about the investigations. When I worked for Bill Clinton in the White House, the Congress under the Republicans investigated all the way down to, get this, his Christmas card list. A two-year investigation, 2 years of Bill Clinton's Christmas card list. Republicans ought not go that far. But if it were me, it'd be two things.
Democrats
ought not go that far with Bush. But I would do two. I would do the money that James suggests, the contracting and the corruption. I also think we need to know where we lied to, by whom, and why. But here's what's going to happen. Democrats take the House, we'll have a constitutional crisis. Save this tape. Democrats will subpoena, legitimately, the oversight authority under the Constitution. The President of the United States will say no. It will be like segregation. It'll be massive resistance. He'll tell Nancy Pelosi, you send the Capitol Police, I'll send the 101st Airborne, we'll meet on the Mall and see who
on
wins.
On what grounds? Executive privilege?
He'll claim, look what they did with Dick Cheney and the Energy Task Force. And they won in the courts with their right-wing judges. They're gonna claim executive privilege, national security, the dog ate my homework, anything and everything. It'll be massive resistance. And, you know, God help the Republic. I'm not entirely sure. I have less faith in our federal courts since Bush v. Gore than ever in my life. And I'm educated as a lawyer. But I think it's going to be an enormous constitutional crisis.
I'm going to save this tape.
Thank you.
Sonia in Brooklyn, you're on the air. Hello. Sonia, are you there?
Hello.
Hi.
Hi. I'm calling. It is relevant to what the last caller talked about. I believe that the majority of people in the United States don't vote. And from what I know, my sense is that many of them are distrustful and anti-war and economically insecure.
What's your question?
And I'm wondering if the Democratic Party has a strategy or thought about how to inspire these voters or these non-voters to go to the polls.
Paul Begala, in a year where turnout is supposed to be the make-or-break dynamic, that's an important question.
It is, and I think it's one of the reasons, to circle back to where we began, that President Clinton, who has been very good boy about not criticizing his successor, it's sometimes, I suspect, great personal pain. When he stood up and slapped back and said, no, actually, we were very strong on terrorism and it was my successor who was weak, that rallies that base, right? That tells that woman that maybe there are some Democrats who are willing to stand up to these people for this god-awful war they led us into. So it is giving me great hope. I spent a lot of time campaigning for challengers for House races. And if you bring this new class of people who I've been out and seeing in this campaign, you'll have a different tone in a Democratic Party. It'd be a good one.
We're just about out of time, but first, we have a moment with a man who might be running for the Democratic nomination to replace President Bush in 2008. Former Virginia Governor Mark Warner taps into his inner Mr. Rogers. Let's watch.
Hi, I'm Mark Warner, former Governor of Virginia. Please take a moment and fill out some information and add me as a friend on Facebook. Thanks a lot.
All right, James Carville, have you ever heard of Facebook?
I've heard of it, yes.
It's like MySpace for college students. Yeah. So, again.
That's one of the few. Look, he's a tech guy, started like a phone business. He's a gazillionaire. He relates to people. I think he's relating to young people there. But I kind of like it. I think we need to do that kind of stuff. I mean, it's not going to win the election for him or anything, but I think it's effective and shows him as a kind of guy that is kind of hip and knows what's going on.
All right. Give me a number. How many seats are the Democrats going to pick up?
It will be less than 7 or more than 20.
Less than 7 or more than 20.
It'll break one way or the other. I mean, the conventional wisdom is that it's going to be somewhere between 14 and 20. And I think it's going to break one way or the other. My guess is it'll break in the Democrats' favor, but it could break against
them. They need 15 seats to take that control in the House. What would make it break the other way?
Against them?
Yes.
Some really good news on the war against terror or the war in Iraq, which we all pray for. Right, they captured bin Laden, or there's this big joke out there that, you know, Karl Rove's going to drag him out of the freezer and say, oh, yeah, I got
him. Declining gas prices?
Not enough.
Not enough.
Paul Begala, James Carville, thank you both.
Thanks, Brian.
So very much.
Appreciate it.
Coming up next, Keith Olbermann channels Edward R. Murrow. We will look at one of Olbermann's recent opinionated soliloquies and put it in the context of TV history. This is Brian Lehrer Live.
Prominent professors, outstanding students, illustrious alumni, all on the Emmy-nominated magazine show about CUNY. Hi, I'm Valerie Vasquez. Join us this Sunday when we'll bring you the stories about the people and programs that make CUNY a place where you study with the best.
There is really only one boy. One girl. One tree. One forest. One deep dancing ocean. One mountain calling. One handful of sand through our fingers. One endless sky overhead. And one simple way to care for it all. Please visit earthshare.org and learn how the world's leading environmental groups are working together under one name. Earthshare. One environment. One simple way to care for it.
This is Brian Lehrer Live. We're here live Wednesday nights at 7:30. Cable news channel hosts are often known for, let's say, their strong opinions and theatrical presentations, usually from the right. But MSNBC's Keith Olbermann has been getting increasingly aggressive in his criticisms of President Bush. And we're hardly the only ones to notice that Olbermann quoted the legendary CBS television newsman Edward R. Murrow during one of these recent rants, and even seemed to be channeling Murrow in his presentation style. Now, it was 1954 when Murrow challenged the anti-communist smear campaign of right-wing Senator Joseph McCarthy. So we thought we'd watch a little Murrow, a little bit of actor David Strathairn doing Murrow in a movie, and then Keith Olbermann doing Murrow in real life. We'll also talk about the moving line in the media today between journalism and commentary. Here is Edward R. Murrow talking about Senator McCarthy on CBS in 1954.
1 month ago tonight, we presented a report on Senator Joseph R. McCarthy. We labeled it as controversial. Most of that report consisted of words and pictures of the senator. At that time, we said, if the senator believes we have done violence to his words or pictures, if he desires to speak, to answer himself, an opportunity will be afforded him on this program. The senator sought the opportunity, asked for a delay of 3 weeks because, he said, he was very busy, and he wished adequate time to prepare his reply. We agreed. We supplied the senator with a kinescope of that program of March 9, and with such scripts and recordings as he requested. We placed no restrictions upon the manner or method of the presentation of his reply. And we suggested that we would not take time to comment on this particular program. The senator chose to make his reply on film. Here now is Senator Joseph R. McCarthy, junior senator from Wisconsin.
Edward R. Murrow from 1954. And if that whet your appetite for more Murrow, here is a little more. Actor David Strathairn from last year's movie about Murrow and his producer Fred Friendly called Good Night and Good Luck. The face is David Strathairn's, but the words are the real words of Murrow, also from 1954.
Earlier the senator asked, upon what meat does this our Caesar feed? Had he looked three lines earlier in Shakespeare's Caesar, he would have found this line, which is not altogether inappropriate. The fault, dear Brutus, is not in our stars, but in ourselves. No one familiar with the history of this country can deny that congressional committees are useful. It is necessary to investigate before legislating, but the line between investigating and persecuting is a very fine one, and the junior senator from Wisconsin has stepped over it repeatedly. We must not confuse dissent with disloyalty. We must remember always that accusation is not proof, and that conviction depends upon evidence and due process of law. We will not walk in fear one of another. We will not be driven by fear into an age of unreason if we dig deep in our history and our doctrine, and remember that we are not descended from fearful men, not from men who feared to write, to associate, to speak, and to defend the causes that were for the moment unpopular. This is no time for men who oppose Senator McCarthy's methods to keep silent, or for those who approve. We can deny our heritage and our history, but we cannot escape responsibility for the results. We proclaim ourselves, indeed as we are, the defenders of freedom wherever it continues to exist in the world, but we cannot defend freedom abroad by deserting it at home. The actions of the junior senator from Wisconsin have caused alarm and dismay amongst our allies abroad and given considerable comfort to our enemies. And whose fault is that? Not really his. He didn't create this situation of fear. He merely exploited it, and rather successfully. Cassius was right. The fault, dear Brutus, is not in our stars, but in ourselves. Good night, and good luck.
David Strathairn playing Edward R. Murrow in the movie Good Night and Good Luck. And now we get to Keith Olbermann. Here is about 2 minutes of Keith Olbermann trying to be a modern-day Murrow on MSNBC on September 8th, earlier this month.
And now a special comment about the president's speech today. It is to our deep national shame, and ultimately it will be to the president's deep public regret, that he has followed his Secretary of Defense down the path of trying to tie those loyal Americans who disagree with his policies or even question their effectiveness or execution to the Nazis of the past and the Al-Qaeda of the present. Today, in the same subtle terms in which Mr. Bush and his colleagues muddied the clear line separating Iraq and 9/11 without ever actually saying so, the president quoted a purported Osama bin Laden letter that spoke of launching, quote, a media campaign to create a wedge between the American people and their government. Make no mistake here, the intent of that is to get us to confuse the psychotic scheming of an international terrorist with that familiar bogeyman of the far right, the quote, media, unquote. The president and the vice president and others have often attacked freedom of speech and freedom of dissent and freedom of the press. Now Mr. Bush has signaled that his unparalleled and unprincipled attack on reporting has a new and venomous side angle. The attempt to link by the simple expediency of one word, media, the honest, patriotic, indeed vital questions and questioning from American reporters with the evil of Al-Qaeda propaganda. That linkage is more than just indefensible. It is un-American. Mr. Bush and his colleagues have led us before to such waters. We will not drink again. And the president's rewriting and sanitizing of history so it fits the expediencies of domestic politics today is just as false and just as scurrilous.
A failed Austrian painter published a book in which he explained his intention to build an Aryan superstate in Germany and take revenge on Europe and eradicate the Jews. The world ignored Hitler's words and paid a terrible price.
Whatever the true nature of Al-Qaeda and other international terrorist threats, to ceaselessly compare them to the Nazi state of Germany serves only to embolden them. Moreover, Mr. Bush, you are accomplishing in part what Osama bin Laden and others seek, a fearful American populace, easily manipulated and willing to throw away any measure of restraint, any loyalty to our own ideals and freedoms for the comforting illusion of safety. It thus becomes necessary to remind the president that his administration's recent Nazi kick is an awful and a cynical thing, and it becomes necessary to reach back into our history for yet another quote from yet another time, and to ask it of Mr. Bush. Have you no sense of decency, sir?
Keith Olbermann from September 8th, quoting Edward R. Murrow and the famous words he used on Joe McCarthy, have you no shame? With me now to talk about Murrow's old and new, real and portrayed, and the issues the Olbermann moment raises for journalism is Paul Levinson, journalism professor at Fordham University. Professor Levinson, welcome to the program.
Good to be here, Brian.
Was Keith Olbermann basically channeling, doing Edward R. Murrow there?
Well, I think it's irresistible. You know, the movie Good Night and Good Luck was so successful that I think if I were a news anchor or having anything to do with news or news commentary, you know, I have like a little bit of dark hair, and if I can at all muster a basso profundo voice, and I'm on that same side of the political spectrum, sure. And I think Olbermann is actually doing a good job, and it's something that's helpful to our democracy.
This kind of thing didn't really exist in our media 10 years ago. We had maybe some hard-hitting pieces on 60 Minutes that kind of came from a point of view. You know, there was there was talk radio, but on television, straight news, maybe 60 Minutes with an investigative tough piece, but nothing like this.
Well, I've been saying that I think we're now in a new golden age of television. There's an entertainment part of that, and there's also a news part of it. And the news part of it is 100% because of cable. And actually not 100%, of course, YouTube and the internet is feeding into that as well. But the traditional networks really have been ossified and brittle since the 1970s. They haven't done much of anything that's
new. Now, you're talking about a golden age. But, you know, usually when people talk about O'Reilly and all these other guys on talk TV, they talk about it as degrading our democracy. I mean, this is what journalism professors say, because it's so over the top, it's so clownish, it's so, you know, false outrage driven.
Well, I'm a journalism professor, and I definitely don't say that. And in fact, what I say is that human beings don't live by the bread of news alone. We need the spice of hectoring. We need the speaker's corner in Hyde Park. We need feisty op-eds in newspapers. And we need people like O'Reilly and Olbermann expressing their points of view, because it gets us to thinking. One of my favorite philosophers, Karl Popper, said the best way of refuting something is to present the best possible case for the argument that you don't agree with. Then you see it as clearly as possible, and you can come up with arguments against it. So watching O'Reilly is great for that. And the same is true with people who might not agree with what Olbermann is saying. Just having someone boringly deliver the news is really yesterday's television at this point.
You know what? I'm going to throw this out to you, our viewers. I wonder if any of you have an opinion. Is television better today than it was 10 years ago? Is television better today, television news now, news and information, better today than it was in Murrow's day? Maybe some of you watching are old enough to remember. Is television better now than 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 50 years ago? 212-251-0801. 212-251-0801. You've done some of these shows, right? You've been on O'Reilly as a guest,
right,
on Scarborough Country.
Right. Yes.
Are you cast as the liberal?
I'm cast as a lunatic. I think they don't quite
know what to expect.
They
cast everybody
as a lunatic. Yeah, that's right. And it's certainly not as enjoyable as talking to you. And you're lucky if you get a word in edgewise on many of these shows.
Why do you do it?
Well, I do it for a couple of reasons. If I want to look at the least egotistical, most idealistic reason, it's because I truly believe that it's good to get even a little bit of truth out there, even if it's masticated in that talk show format. The egotistical reason is, you know, I enjoy my wife and kids and friends seeing me on television. You know, there's nothing like it. And that's true, but the most serious thing is I think that we need a diversity of opinion. And even if you can just express your opinions very briefly in a hostile environment, that's better than having, you know, Newt Gingrich on, you know, who's one of O'Reilly's most frequent guests, giving his analysis of Clinton versus Wallace, which is a complete waste of time.
So let me ask you the eternal media commentary bias question. Why do you think talk radio and talk television are so dominated by conservatives when the electorate tends to be 50-50?
I think it's just a coincidence. And if you look at the history, for example, of newspapers, there have been times when the newspapers have been dominated by what we would take call the liberal agenda. There were times when the conservatives, like Hearst and other people in the early part of the 20th century, controlled most of the newspapers. So there really isn't much beyond just the coincidence of who happens to be on the news. And, for example, Keith Olbermann is not doing all that well in the ratings. That's, I think, because NBC has a very poor format. One of these days, they'll understand you don't stick in 2 or 3 hours of documentaries right in the middle of the evening, and you don't put some of the other things on that they do, and then they'll do much better.
I wonder if they're finding some success with Olbermann ramping it up now against the Bush administration. He's surrounded by conservatives on that channel pretty much, as well as on the Fox News channel. But he did that September 8th thing. That started to get passed around the internet a lot. I'll bet as many people saw it on YouTube as saw it on MSNBC on September 11th. Then he did a whole other thing in front of Ground Zero. And just the other night, Monday night, he did a long, angry rant against President Bush with language that you never hear on network television against the president.
That's right, and I think that's good. There's nothing wrong with being insulting to a president. That's what democracy is all about. Incidentally, there was nothing wrong with Chris Wallace, I think, asking that question. I like Clinton's response, but people who are saying, oh, it was, you know, he shouldn't have asked that question to the president, that those questions don't get it.
Of course, he had to ask that question, because after the ABC TV movie controversy, that was one of the most salient questions to ask President Clinton in the public's mind.
Absolutely.
Ellen, in Washington Heights, is TV news better today than in the past?
Not really. I think it's terrible. It's so boring, because you watch 2, 4, 7, which are the main channels, and they all say exactly the same thing, like there's nothing else happening on this earth. And it's
Do you watch
fluff.
The cable news channels, Ellen? Do you watch CNN, MSNBC,
no,
Fox?
No, I watch you. I only have the minimum cable because I travel a lot. So I'm never home, so I don't want to spend $54. So I'd only spend $14. So I see you guys, 21, BBC,
okay,
and the normal channels.
All right. And so you think it was better 20 years ago? I don't know how old you were.
Yes. Because it seems they all get the news from the same spot, and they're just mouthing the same thing. I don't understand it.
Thank you very much.
Well, she's completely right, and this is actually what I was saying. Network news is much worse today than it was 30 years ago, certainly when Edward R. Murrow or even Walter Cronkite was on. And that's why, you know, CBS, they went through this, you know, all this hoopla about putting Katie Couric on there. I think she's very good. But basically, the format is tired, and it is indeed just the same boring stuff over and over again. And cable is by no means perfect, but by and large, it's a breath of fresh air where there is exploration of all kinds of issues that you wouldn't see on network news.
Anyone else agree with Ellen, disagree with Ellen, and agree with Professor Levinson? Is TV news, the totality of TV news, better today than it was 10, 20, 30, 40 years ago? 212-251-0801, 251-0801. Do a little journalism history for us. 1954, when those Murrow clips were from, television as a mass medium that was really in people's homes was only like 5 years old. How groundbreaking was that?
Well, television is extraordinary in the history of media. Usually it takes decades for a new medium to catch on. To give you just one example, the telephone was introduced in 1876. You would think it would have caught on very, very quickly. People loved to talk on the phone. At that same period of time in the mid-1950s, that was the first time in American history that more than 50% of Americans had phone service in their homes and apartments. Television was invented in the late 1920s, but it wasn't commercially introduced until the late 1940s. By the end of the 1950s, it was well in over 90% of American homes. So what you're seeing with Edward R. Murrow is the beginning of an extraordinary launch that was like a rocket in the history of media
but
and journalism.
But given what else we've been talking about tonight, it kind of went away for 40 years. Then there was just straight news, right? And it was very difficult. Anybody who saw Good Night and Good Luck knows that Murrow was only able to get away with that hard-hitting commentary because he was so personally popular, and he had to fight the network brass at CBS even to go after Joe McCarthy.
Well, there were some bright moments. For example, the 1968 Democratic Convention in Chicago, Dan Rather standing up to Mayor Daley's thugs, as Walter Cronkite from the control booth called them. So there were some exciting moments, but you're right. By and large, as television became so enormously successful, it lost some of its cutting edge. And it wasn't really until the 1980s when cable began asserting itself, and first with CNN, and then in the 1990s, eventually Fox News and MSNBC, that television news again became cutting edge.
Kevin on Staten Island, you're on the air. Hi, Kevin.
Hi, how are you?
Good. So?
Good. I'm calling in regards to the just a comment about the way news television is going now. Mm-hmm. And I just feel that it isn't as liberal as your guest is saying. They're not really posing the hard questions. They more or less, I don't know whether it's mandated from the owners of the station or, you know, they just made up their mind that they're just going to go along to get any type of news out of the White House.
Kevin, do you watch the cable news channels?
Yes, I watch C-SPAN. I watch all the Sunday news shows. I listen to you and Amy Goodman on, during the week on the radio. So I try to get a little bit of everything from everybody. But I just, other than Meet the Press, I do like Meet the Press. But other than that, I feel a lot of these shows, such as Fox and ABC and CBS, they're not really, and I don't even want to talk about CNN, I don't really think that they're posing the real questions, why, what, where, and how.
Right. Kevin, thank you very much. You know, he mentioned C-SPAN, which is another thing that could make this, if not a golden age of television, at least an improved age of television information.
Yeah. Well, I think C-SPAN has been doing an important, quiet job. You know, it's not the most scintillating television in the world to just see someone standing up and talking somewhere. But, you know, there's sort of no comments on whatever they're portraying is an unusual form of television. But I think it's doing a good job. But I do want to say, I mean, again, see, all this is mixed together. If you talk about CBS and ABC, then right, they're part of the problem. They're the traditional tired networks. As far as Fox, CNN, and NBC, I mean, MSNBC, they're far from perfect. But by and large, they have a lot of different material, things that you did not see and do not see now covered on the network.
And we haven't even mentioned the Internet, which isn't television, but the Internet changes everything, at least potentially. And so I also think that it's actually a much better total media environment today than it was in Murrow's day. However, could there be another Edward R. Murrow with so many channels and audiences fractured into smaller and smaller blocks? Even if Keith Olbermann is speaking, you know, God's own truth, could he have the impact today that Murrow had on McCarthyism in the 1950s?
Well, Hegel, a great philosopher, used to talk about the spirit of an age, as he termed it. And what that meant was every once in a while, certain factors come together, and the popular culture is just right, the political climate is just right, and you have a certain profound development, and it's never seen exactly like that again. So the 50s did have Murrow, the 60s, of course, you know, flower power, the protests against the war in Vietnam, you know, the various things.
And we have to leave it there. We're out of time. Paul Levinson is chair of Communications and Media Studies at Fordham University. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
And that's it for tonight's show. We're here live Wednesday nights at 7:30. Next week, more coverage of the online battle for control of Congress. And join me for my daily radio show, weekday mornings at 10 on WNYC, New York Public Radio. Tomorrow morning, we continue our 2006 election series, 30 issues in 30 days. Our topic tomorrow, no more Jack Abramoffs. That's on AM 820 and FM 93.9 WNYC, tomorrow morning at 10. Have a great night.
I did.